Come on, you gotta take your time.
Coloring shapes and giving love to the family puppy.
I love you.
Josh Holmes looks like a typical 3-year-old, but lodged deep in his bones, circulating through his blood, lurks an insidious enemy.
It made me feel like I wasn't being a good parent when I found out he had lead poisoning. And I know I'm a clean person. I keep my hygiene together. I keep my house together. What did I do wrong as a parent?
The father that I am, cleaning up after them, changing diapers, teaching them, you know, what I can teach them. And something like that happened. It made me feel a little negligent, like it was my fault.
You want to go outside?
What Joe and Ebony Holmes didn't know is that the yellow house they were renting on Cleveland's Near West Side had become a serious threat. There are various ways children can become poisoned by lead. The most common originates from lead-based paint commonly used in homes built before the mid-1960s. Old paint chips shedding off poorly maintained walls and windowsills eventually turn into dust that contaminates surfaces or outside soil where children play.
If there's dust on the windowsills and it's got the lead in it, then they're touching the windowsills, hands are going to the mouth.
All right, let's take a listen.
While poisoning can occur anywhere there's lead paint, the highest concentration of lead poisoned children in Cuyahoga County live in inner ring suburbs and urban neighborhoods.
A lot of them live in houses that they're renting, and the owners have not bothered to remove the lead because of the expense that comes with it.
Good breath. To this side.
Ohio law mandates that all low-income children on Medicaid be tested for lead exposure at age 1 and 2. A level of 5 or above is considered elevated. The level for Josh Holmes when he was age 2 was 49, a medical emergency.
So a lead level 45 micrograms and higher are admitted to the hospital to get medicine called chelation to remove lead from the body. And in his case, he got an oral chelation medicine.
It's going to be real fast. Remember, you're the big boy. You're the man.
Josh must now get regular blood draws to keep tabs on his lead levels, which still hover in the 30s. Even with treatment, some level of lead will always remain in his body.
It's hard, and that makes me cry because it's been a long time of pain, you know, especially for something that's not his fault.
Children can face life-threatening medical problems from severe lead poisoning, but there can be other dangerous consequences even from low levels of exposure.
Kids can have problems such as hearing loss. They can have problems with an attention span. They can have a slight lowered IQ.
It impacts how they learn, how they develop, how they grow up, how they do in school.
And in some cases, it may also influence future behavior.
Research on children with lead poisoning shows consequences can stretch further than just lower IQ scores and other cognitive problems. Childhood lead poisoning has also been shown to be a risk factor for adult criminal behavior.
Lead exposure is certainly a factor. Our study was the first to really document it convincingly.
At the University of Cincinnati, Professor Kim Dietrich heads up the Cincinnati Lead Study, which has followed hundreds of lead-exposed children from birth into young adulthood. Among their findings, they found an association between lead poisoning and the number of arrests. Participants with the highest lead levels in childhood had the greatest number of arrests, including some for violent offenses, by the time they reached adulthood.
Lead exposure is not the complete story. It doesn't completely explain what's going on with these children. They have a lot of other challenges, but lead exposure is one of them.
Children who live in poverty and have the added burden of lead poisoning face a particularly tough road.
It's a double whammy, and it's unnecessary. And so the kids from the start, you know, are already behind the eight ball before they even get started with their life.
But experts all agree, lead poisoning does not have to be an automatic curse to a child's future. With access to early, high-quality health care, enriched educational programs, and good parenting, many poisoned children can thrive. Ebony and Joe Holmes remain dedicated to doing all they can for their son.
Here, Josh. Want an egg? What do you say?
Josh is now enrolled in a Head Start preschool, and the Holmes were able to move to a new, well-maintained home where Dad is quick to repair any cracking paint and Mom stays compulsive about dust. Still, Ebony Holmes continues to worry.
It's messing with his learning ability is what I fear about it. Him being able to comprehend things fast, and he's pretty smart, you know. I think he beat the odds with it, but you never know. And it's a long life ordeal until he gets old enough for us to be able to recognize if he has an issue.
As the Holmes fight feelings of anger and guilt, they've also discovered a strong sense of purpose to educate other families about the dangers of lead poisoning.
I think it's been an experience to teach me and my husband something. This was our purpose to, you know, this happened to us for a reason, because we're able to talk about it and put it out there for people.
When I come home from work and he says, Daddy, I miss you, Daddy. Daddy, that's my daddy. So that keeps me going forward, you know.
Six-year-old Carmelo is proving to be quite a handful for his mother, Jackie Gandarella. She worries about his behavior, especially in school.
He will stomp his feet up and down. He will throw a tantrum. You can't calm him down.
So probably between like the vitamins and good nutrition.
Carmelo and his two younger siblings have tested positive for lead poisoning. Carmelo initially had a level of 33, which is 28 units above what is considered problematic.
When your lead is that high up, that affects your brain. Like, you can cause brain damage from that.
Jay Schneider is a Philadelphia researcher who studies the effects of lead on the brain. He presented some of his findings at the 2015 Healthy Homes and Lead Poisoning Conference in Cleveland. In one animal study, Schneider found that exposing brain tissue to even low levels of lead reduced the fiber connections brain cells use to communicate,
which can dramatically affect the way that brain is going to function later on.
Well, this is an actual human brain.
To understand the effects of lead on actual human brains, we need a quick lesson in anatomy. Neuropathologist Mark Cohen explains the average adult human brain weighs about 3 pounds, and functions are usually divided into left and right side activities.
In most patients, in most people, the dominant hemisphere is the left, and what that means is that language function is handled predominantly on the left.
But when Kim Dietrich studied the brains of individuals who were lead poisoned as children, he found evidence that language and speech functions were taking place on the right side. Dietrich says such reorganization costs the brain in terms of overall function.
Any cost reduces the brain's total ability to fully function as it was meant to, as it was meant to be wired.
Dietrich and his colleagues also found actual shrinkage in some areas of the brain of lead-poisoned individuals, especially among males.
We found that reductions in the cortical areas were in parts of the brain that are associated with judgment, impulse control, anticipation of consequences, areas that we associate, that psychologists call the executive functions.
Any concerns at all today?
Given the science, experts say society needs to rethink how it approaches the problem of childhood lead poisoning.
I think we need to really get into the mindset of just thinking about a lead poisoned child as a child having a brain injury, and then deal with it from that perspective.
Dr. Dore Dearborn believes in the ability of the young brain to compensate from lead exposure when given early support. He chairs a Cuyahoga County task force dedicated to getting all lead-poisoned children into high-quality preschools. In the current system, he says it's hit or miss as to whether a lead-poisoned child gets any special help.
So there's a lot of holes in the education system that's not working for these kids.
Right. But we're learning where they are, and we're getting people to say, whoa, we should change that.
Dearborn points to data collected from the kindergarten readiness test of thousands of children in Cleveland public schools as justification to push for early intervention. Compared to the highest scoring students, kids with the lowest literacy scores were almost twice as likely to be lead poisoned. Dearborn remains especially worried about children with low levels of poisoning who often slip through the cracks and struggle in school. He says it can be one underlying factor, along with things like poverty, that can set children on the wrong path.
The problems that we see with inner city youth, the difficulty in school performance, the decreased graduation rate in our inner city high schools, aggressive bullying behavior, that's a significant societal impact.
Besides developing tailored educational programs for poisoned children, experts say it's also important to educate parents.
That's a key component with these children. The parents realize, hey, you know, I've got a behavioral problem kid, or I've got a kid that may not be performing in preschool or whatever as well. I need to spend more time with them. I need to, at home, I need to read to them. I need to work with them. And, you know, that's going to go a long ways.
You've done a great job.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're good.
Jackie Gandarella regularly takes her children to Metro Health's lead clinic to keep tabs on their levels, which have fallen.
Mama, come in the water.
At home, she washes their hands frequently. The house she rents has lots of chipping paint, and lead has been found in the soil.
You're trying to do some stuff around the house,
yes,
right?
I'm
You're
painting trying to the house, you know, the porch. I'm about to paint over everything with new paint, so maybe just stop the lead from coming into his body.
So far, Gandarella says Carmelo has not received any special help in school, but each day she gets a report from his kindergarten teacher.
He brings a behavior chart home every day, and he has to get 9 stickers to get a treat.
Today's update shows Carmelo used profanity in math class.
And what made you write the B word on this paper? You wrote B word all over the paper. He was mad.
Yes.
My number one worry is Carmelo's going to get worse into his behavior, or it's not. I'm not going to be able to control it. I'm going to try to get some type of help for him with that, like put him in counseling or something where they can help me with him with the behavior-wise.
As Carmelo hangs over the porch railing, his mother holds out hope. Maybe next week, he'll bring home those 9 stickers.